We got one.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Okay, we got Lisa back there.
Let's go back to our text and now work through our further points. So under our first point, we are considering it all joy. And I will emphasize that the word consider there, that Greek term consider there, needs to be understood as let this attitude dominate or lead or be a controlling factor in the way you perceive trials. Let the joy of the Lord dominate the way you perceive your trial. You know how when we go through trials and we get ready to see it in a moment, we don't know what to think. Anchor yourself in the Word of God and think this way, that your trial is from God, that your trial is designed to glorify God, that your trial is going to grow you up, and your trial is going to bring you to a place of affirming the promises of God in your life. Let that lead in your thinking. Here comes the trial. Okay, Lord, you are up to something.
Your breath, exhale down, turn that left one out.
I love this example. I'm going to use one and move forward. David began to learn this. You know, David was a man just like you and I, and he had a lot of problems.
So wide across
but as he is running the kingdom, at this time he's going downhill because his son Absalom is seeking to kill him, and the kingdom is going through trouble. And you know, when your life goes through trouble, you're going to be able to see who your friends are from your constituents. Because your constituents are going to see you as falling, and your friends are going to see you as being drawn near, closer to God. Your constituents might even expose themselves to be your enemies, like Shimei did when he openly stood up and started cursing David, because David is dealing with the rebel son Absalom, and it appears like the kingdom is falling apart. Child of God, remember what I said to us last week. God gives us eyes of faith so that we see realities that are beyond what is present. Often we try to judge people based upon what they're going through, but our elder told us this morning, don't do that. Some of you who are doing well in the flesh are far from God.
Leg is straight, working your thigh.
And those of you who are going through all sorts of trouble are in God's presence every day. Who's the better off? Are you hearing what I'm saying? So the text is teaching us about that. And so the whole idea here that we are working through concerning counting all joy is the idea of letting the proper attitude and understanding that God is working out something in our life dominate our thinking so that we don't question or don't doubt God. So with that, there are three things that fall out quickly. Let's look at them. Three things that fall out that I want us to think about. Three of them. And it's called knowing, submitting, and what? Seeking.
Don't feel it.
Three things that should fall out of grown folks' joy anytime you and I fall into trials. Three things that should be the natural response from us. And the first thing is that we should know certain things. We should know this, that when trials come, God is going to show himself faithful in our life. Right? And so what we know is, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, there is no trial, no difficulty, no trouble that is not common to the believer, that God also will not, in that trial, make a way for you to be able to bear up under it. Not deliver you out of it, bear up under it. Because remember, why would God send a trial in your life? Only to take it away. But the trial is designed to shape you and conform you to the image of Christ. Now, so if you're thinking with grown folks' joy, here's what you're going to do. Okay, Lord, somehow you're going to use this crazy thing to make me look like Christ. So help me embrace it, even though I don't like it, because I know your ways are better than my ways. Am I telling the truth? So this is what the text is teaching us to do, to be able to allow a gospel mindset to remember that God is faithful. God's not going to put me in a trial and let me sink under that trial so that I lose my faith in Christ, end up abandoning God and going to hell. God will never do that with those of us who are truly his. We learned that this morning under the preservation and perseverance of the saints, right? So God is faithful. God is faithful. Moreover, here's a promise. I think you know it. It's Psalm 34, verse 9. Many
raise up on those toes.
Many are the afflictions of the righteous.
Nothing changes. We got the body. We're still pushing away from the floor.
So mark this now before you go to the last part. Westerners love to go to the last part of the verse. They love to go to the last part of the verse. Stay on the first part first. Many, not few, many are the afflictions of the righteous. Now, if this is so, we have a clearer picture of what the life of faith looks like for the believer.
Let's do a push-up. Elbows,
chest, many are the afflictions of the righteous. But God would allow you to go around the kingdom of God with his holy angels and look at the lives of the saints.
Left leg.
You would see trouble after trouble after trouble after trouble after trouble after trouble. Issue after issue after issue. Problem after problem after problem. Difficulty after difficulty. Everywhere you go, the saints will be going through difficulty. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. But now, it is a grown,
much
joyful attitude.
Do not push
it. Do
not push
it. Do you understand what I mean by joy now? The joy that God is faithful, who allows you to go into that trial, to go through that trial, to bring you out of that trial, making you what he intends to make you by taking you into that trial. This is what James wants you to get as you and I are working through Grown Folks Joy. The second sub-point is what? Submitting. Why would we, knowing that God will deliver us through, as he said he would, also then submit? What we are submitting to is the process.
Just kidding.
Oh, this is the hard part for teenagers. And this is the hard part for new believers. Because as we have given to us in one of our previous bulletins, a hymn that was written by John Newton, I asked the Lord that I might grow. You guys remember that one? I asked the Lord that I might grow in more of his grace and favor. No, I asked that he might show me more of his glory and of his splendor and beauty, and that I might also grow in my walk and in my duty. But it has been in such a way that broke me almost to despair. The Lord laid me low, destroyed all my plans and schemes. Wondering whether or not God even loves me. Y'all understand what I'm talking about? That's the way they think like Romans. Because that's the way God works. When he's conforming you to Christ, not to you. Remember, God is your God, you're not his God. And so thinking God's thoughts after him is all about growing up in Christ. And I think most of you, if you ever read the hymn by John Newton, I asked the Lord that I might grow, you would discover that that is so much true for the believer, but it's a hard thing to endure. And yet it is the case. So what are we to do when we're going through trials? We are to make sure that our mind is conforming to the will of God. For two reasons. One is, it makes the trial easier. Secondly, the trial ain't going away anyway. You can think how you want to think, you still gonna go through the trial. You understand?
Wow.
So, now our third sub-point is gonna actually launch us into our second point as well. Not only do we want to submit to the process because the process is going to accomplish its purpose, but then we want to seek to what? Understand by faith in the midst of the trial what's going on. This is so very good. So I want to remember and know that God is faithful to deliver me. I want to submit to the process because it will strengthen me, it will mature me as God supplies his grace in my life. But I also am going to seek to understand my faith in the midst of this trial, whatever it is that God wants me to know. Now here is the hinge pin that goes to the next point.
First.
Why do I want to seek God in the midst of the trial? Because I want to grow in knowing how God thinks and acts so that I can be more consistent with his thinking and acting as I go through the trial so that I in turn can tell other people this is how God works. You see, when we say that we know God, we ought to be able to demonstrate that we know God by the trials we go through.
Feel strong.
Isn't it comforting when you meet a believer?
Yeah.
Okay, God,
we're trying to go back here.
Through a difficult mess.
Looking good.
It's a child.
No sweat yet.
Son, my God, let me show you how God works.
5 seconds to the end.
This is the God of the Bible. This is the God of our grace. This is the God of our salvation. And he works this way consistently. Follow these instructions. Do this. Follow that and watch God come through. See, these are the mature people in the faith who can help you see beyond the darkness and obscurity of their trials. boots. This is what the tour is all about. So we want to do what? We want to see when we are in the midst of the trials, to understand by faith what's taking place. Now, I think I have it in my outline. You may have it as well. It does not occur automatically. This is absolutely amazing. Look at verses 3 through 5, and then I'll make my emphasis on this point, and then we'll begin to move to our final point. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh what? Knowing that this, that is the trying of your faith, worketh patience, and therefore let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect, entire, and wanting nothing. So verse 3 underscores that if we know this, if we know that God is faithful, if we know that submitting to Him in the process of growth will strengthen us, mature us, and to supply us with everything that we need, then we can know this, that patience is going to have her perfect work, so that you and I will mature. We will have everything we need, and we will not be lacking.
It's okay, because guess what?
As a word, James says, if you handle trials right, you will discover that you don't need anything in your trial but God.
Two, side, one, out.
Oh, this is good.
So let
me see if I can explain this very clearly. Because the next verses are going to underscore it, because he's getting ready to deal with a horrible negative. A horrible negative. If your trials don't lead you to pray, to seek God, you're going somewhere else.
We're doing crossovers here. 5 seconds.
If you go somewhere else, you will not have God's blessing.
Now remember, this is our pace. Our pace is not
so what he says in verse 3, let patience have a perfect work. The word patience there is the word to
get to.
Let the weight of the trial.
Is
do what it's supposed
the
to
transitions.
Do. Don't throw it off your shoulders. Let the weight of the trial do what it's supposed to. Let it weigh you down. Let it keep weighing you down.
Four,
let it exhaust
three,
your energy, because naturally we push against the trial with our strength. Let it weigh you down to the point where your strength becomes so weak that naturally now you've got to call for some help.
Because
that trial is making you already looking up if you do know that. So all the form is gone. The form is gone. This is not a trial. You can hold that weight. This is not a trial. When this thing starts doing this, now we got a trial going on. Now, y'all follow what I'm saying? Now we got a trial going on. And when it gets around your neck, when you can't breathe, now we need to get ready to call for somebody that can help us in this situation. All right, so stay here. If you don't know God, you won't call on Him. And if you haven't been calling on God consistently, you won't know how to call on Him in the time of trouble. So for some of you, a real aspect of growing up this year is your intentional discipline of calling on God. Because God has been good to you enough to allow you to go through such a great period of normalcy that you don't know what it's like to be in the time of trouble that's about to take all your air away. And you need to be practicing on how to call on God now. And this is why prayer is taught to us in all sorts of ways. And what I mean by that is, you don't have to always be praying for yourself. Just think for 5 minutes about other people to pray for. And if you love somebody else besides yourself, now you have a ground for grace. And especially if you know people that you care about who are going through trouble, stand in the gap for them as if you were them. And bear the weight of prayer for them so that you can practice so that as soon as it comes your turn, you easily know how to call on the name of the Lord. I will call upon the name of the Lord who will deliver me from all my troubles, and I will praise Him because He is so faithful and good to me. That would be a natural pattern of your life. But a lot of you are not there. You are not there. You are not seeking God in the midst of your trials that you ought to be. I'll just use an example so that we can go on to our next point. The book of Job serves with us as a model of what we are talking about today. The whole book of Job. Job was a man who experienced massive blessings from the Lord at such a level that the devil knew.
What are we doing back there?
That he at least tried Job on these grounds. That Job is serving God. blessed him enormously. Everybody in the land knew how wealthy and prominent and blessed Job was. And so the question merits some consideration. Does a man or a woman see God only because God continues to bless you? Or do you see God because you love him? And God is worthy to be loved. But see, now when you say yes, the trial has to come to prove it. Because God allowed that trial to come in Job's life to prove to the whole world, you and I, that Job loved God for God and not for what God gave him. You with me? And so we saw chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4. Chapter 1 is the Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Yes, if you and I even heard about losing our house or our car, we had a sense. Job lost it all and was able to say, I have a grown folks joy. I have a grown folks joy. So that by the time we get to chapter 14, you know what Job says? I will wait until my appointed time. And I know that God will require the work of his hands. He will return. He will bring me back. He will restore me. He will bring me back into that fullness that he purposed for me before the foundation of the world. By the time we get to chapter 19, what does Job say? I know my Redeemer lasts. Even the worms eat of my body, in my flesh right now, with my own eyes will I behold my Savior as I stand upon the earth. Now that's called grown folks joy when your body is falling apart under disease. You have lost everything in your life, and even your wife is acting crazy. You're all by yourself. All your friends are worse than enemies. The way they are accusing you of going through trouble under the notion that you reap what you sow. Now, when you hold that principle as an absolute, you know nothing about grace or a relationship between God the Father and his sons and daughters. You know nothing about how God loves us enough. That's what we learned in our men's meeting, and we learned it today. All who the Lord loves, he what? And if you are not quickly running to that verse as you interpret the troubles of your brothers and sisters, you are a legalist, a workmonger. You are ignorant about God's words when he loves his children. The moment you want to indict them simply because they're going through trouble.
Starting, here we go.
Are you guys hearing what I'm saying? And Job had to defend himself against his three friends and ultimately shut his mouth as God took him through his trials. And you guys know how it ended. God never told him why.
Three, over. One, two.
Just hold my hand, three, son.
One.
I'll get two, you through this.
Three, four. One, two.
And he blessed me on the other side.
One, two.
Are you guys hearing me? Okay.
So that was one, two.
Was Job seeking God?
That box is the blood box. Here we go.
The nature of Job's prayers were so candid in the book of Job.
Why do you like this?
That you and I would be offended the way Job talked to his God.
What's the matter?
The hell that Job was going through, he let God know, I don't get this. How can I be honest with you? And you know what God would say to us? Yes. And Job unleashed, unfurled on God all kinds of ideas and notions that most of us pious people would tremble to talk to God like that.
Take the break. You need it.
Did God let Job go? Because Job said, I feel like you're an enemy against me. Did God let him go? No, God held him tighter. God held him tighter.
Just keep moving.
God ran him into his bosom. He says, let me talk to you, son. See, it was after Job got let it all out. God drew him to his bosom and said, son, let me holler at you. Because you said a few things I need to come back.
Right?
You said a few things. We learned this in the men's meeting last night. Get the CD. You women can get it too.
Hands are up.
Come and look at how much.
Yes, I'm up.
Where
and
you
go.
Set. Right. So he started getting his whole premise corrected.
Look how tight the elbows
are. He understood that the best thing that he could have done from the beginning,
keep that hand.
Simply trust
hand
God
hand
for the storm. Sometimes he put his hand over his mouth, his face in the dust, and said, God, you're glorious.
He was slower benefits, of course, again.
And he waited till his change came. And it
came. A little bit lower.
See, this is what we're talking about grown folks' joy, grown folks' maturity. It's so critically important. So let me go to my second point because I want to begin to wrap this up. Not only are we to understand that when the trials come, we are to deal with them through a knowledge of God and that he has a process and methodology by which he will bring it to pass. The second point that I want us to get is so very important, and it starts in verse 5. If any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God that gives it to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given to him. But let him ask in what? Not wavering, for he that wavereth is as a wave of the sea. He that wavereth is as a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. Let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord.
Foot adjustment, you can put it wherever you like.
I would
do forward, adjustments. A little bit side, whatever.
It appears to me when you just read the text in a sort of cursory passage that God will not tolerate And when he allows trouble into our life, we question.
Boom. See my foot right here, that little square.
God's not going to tolerate you saying that you possess the faith of God's elect, which was purchased at the death of his son, which promises to keep you until the day of salvation. And you can turn around with your lips and say and act like God doesn't care. God's not going to tolerate the believer. Watch this now. Thinking that he can, as it were, jump over to God, get a little advice from God. And then he'll jump over to the psychologist, get a little advice from him, and then to the psych, and then to the other person, and get a little advice from them, and kind of put it all together. Or decide not to use God's counsel and somebody else's counsel. Stay with me, this is important. Stay with me now, this is important. Because a lot of people do this. A lot of people abandon God's word for human wisdom. For human wisdom. A lot of people say, well, let me read what the Bible, I don't like that. Can somebody tell me else something that might actually comport more with what I'm feeling about this situation? That's a double-minded man. That's a double-minded man. What God is saying is, you will never find in the scripture anybody upon whom I have placed my name, who has called upon me publicly and acknowledged me as their Lord, by which they can actually come visit me. And then go visit indoor and go visit other folks and think that I'm going to bless them. See, Saul is a perfect example of a double-minded man. Saul would seek counsel at God, and then when God would say anything to him, he would run to the witch doctor. That man ended up under the judgment of God. It's really interesting for us to mark this, because I'm telling you now what I see in the life of Christians, and it's bothersome to me.
Boom, get that hat.
I don't think Christians really believe the Bible is the whole counsel of God.
We're starting out, we're learning here.
I don't think that Christians believe that they can hold their position for life and gospel through God's word.
Front left kick now, ready, set. Right leg forward, left leg back, hands are up.
Out of a double-mindedness and seek their refuge.
Introducing your body and routines.
Even though those other sources blatantly and openly contradict.
Good form, good posture, good breathing, taking your supplements.
So now listen to what he says here. This is an interesting metaphorical terminology. He says, but let him ask in faith, nothing but wavering. Don't waver for a moment. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and what? Tossed. You know what he's describing? He's describing the adolescent person, the child. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 14, pull it up. You know what he says? Be no longer tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Do not be children anymore. Is that what it says? Are we talking about growing up this year? And do not be children anymore. Do not be the kind of child that is merely curious about ideas and notions and doctrines and teachings and not committed to Father as your ultimate instructor. Because you will demonstrate being tossed to and fro. Do y'all know those Christians? Tossed to and fro. And God says, here's the reason why you double-minded. He says they lay in wait, cunning craftiness, whereby they lay in wait to what? Deceive. Our whole world system is deceived by a litany of man-made doctrines and systems. God says in our text, going back to our text, this man is double-minded.
Left leg forward, right leg back.
What if that lamp
try to keep more
knowledge to that lamp.
Try to get a little more involved.
And let that light lead you all the way to glory. And that light is going to be sufficient to lead you through every trouble, every trial, every issue, every pain, every suffering, every conflict. That light's going to stay on for you. And you will never ever need any other revelation but God's revelation. But when God is not speaking to you, you're going to put a bushel over that foot. And you're going to continue walking in darkness. Grown folks' joy then is rooted in you taking your Bible seriously, taking the gospel seriously, taking the means of grace seriously. This is how God works to speak to you, like God is speaking to some of you today. Right? This is some of you today. Here's the other simple test. This one is a little bit mild and we're done here. This is a wonderful pastoral observation that James is making. And this has to do with the context of the churches that he's ministering to. Quite interestingly, James is ministering to two categories of people, though they are largely Jewish. He's ministering to the well-to-do, and he's ministering to the exceedingly poor. The well-to-do and the exceedingly poor are often found in the same building under the same roof in the name of Christianity. Like we would have the well-to-do in our church today, as well as the exceedingly poor. That's just kind of in common parlance. And this is going to be picked up and developed in chapter 2, where James is going to deal with how the well-to-do are given far more credence than the poor in the church. The well-to-do are given the better seats up front. And the poor are told to sit down on the ground in the back. And James is going to destroy that spirit of error in chapter 2. But here's how he starts here, because what James knows is you and I have troubles. When we don't have enough resources to live a life that we can call dignified. We are challenged mentally, emotionally, and spiritually often when we don't have enough by which when people see our lives, we can feel a sense of dignity. We are challenged in our faith before God when our issues are so difficult that we know that what people are saying is, how can they say they know God when they're going through all that? Say with me now. I gave you the answer earlier, but you missed it. And even that person themselves can start hearing the crowding accusations of those who are doing better than them, that you must be under the curse of God. You must be under the judgment of God. All the trouble you're going through, God cannot be for you.
Well, of course now.
And they get tempted to want to have what the wealthy have.
How that feel?
Are you with me? Look at what it says in James chapter 1, verse 9 through 12. For you
them whippersnappers, I got them, sorry.
He says in verse 9, let the brother of low degree, you see it? He cares for him in the church. Rejoice.
We're going to stretch the shoulders, chest a little bit, and the back side of the leg.
And then without breath, he says, but the rich. Now, let me say this as we develop these few verses. The rich, in this context, is just as saved
as wide feet. Turn those hands out.
So when the construction is set this way, but the rich, he's actually identifying the rich with the poor in this common pattern. They're both brothers in Christ. But I want you to see how the struggle works. You with me? The trial of the poor is their poverty. The trial of the rich is their riches. The struggle of the poor is not having what they want. The struggle of the rich is boasting in what they have. Stay with me. Because James now is going to affirm that they're both Christians and let them know you are about to be deceived by what we call temporary matters. See point number two? See what point number two says? What does it say? It's important for you to get this. Keeping an eternal what? Keeping an eternal perspective. What is an eternal perspective? An eternal perspective is a clear, consistent view as to how God sees it for real. Are you with me? Now watch this. You see somebody who has riches today. And you think that this is the way that it's going to always be. But that is not an eternal perspective. You see the first person that's so miserable that you cross the street when you come in contact with them. And you say, that is
chair.
Turn things around.
I'm shaking. Okay.
That was really the test of Job.
Let's go to the next. Let's kind of listen up.
God had to prove that he was his son by doing what? Helping Job understand all this is temporary. Now, do you see the comfort in a poor believer being able to know that all this is temporary? Do you see the comfort in it? The comfort in knowing that I'm broke now, but I'm not going to always be broke.
All right.
And for a lot of reasons, I'm not going to always be broke. One is because God has told me if I come to him and I come to him persistently, he will meet my needs. And one of the reasons I'm broke right now is because God is teaching me something. Grow from joy. One day my tables are going to turn when I learn how to seek him and understand and wait and bear under and let stuff go, because I am discovering that God doesn't bless me while I'm acting a fool.
You see me?
Growing up now. I'm growing up now. God has been waiting for that blessing, And God said, boy, you got to let that other thing go. Now you and I know what that is that has to go. But I want what God wants has for me, and I want to keep this other thing too. Now you got to let it go. So you constantly experience impoverishment of soul while as yet God is waiting for you to seek him.
Drop both legs over to the right side.
And you eventually will.
Same move.
Now the rich, you know what God has to let him know? Tomorrow you can get sick, sir. You can have cancer. And what are your riches going to do for you? Riches do not profit in the day of evil. Neither can they ransom the soul from hell. And God has to actually shake up our lives to help us understand that. So simply in closing, the way this works is, in the original construction, the way this works is, God is actually saying to the poor, he says in verse 9, let the brother of low degree rejoice in his exaltation. And the rich in his humility. And here's how he explains it. For the sun is no sooner risen with the burning heat, but it withers the grass. And the flower thereof, what? Falleth. And the grace of the fashion of it, what? Perishes. So also shall the rich man fade in his way. Do you see it? Here's what he's saying. Brother, those riches ain't going to be around forever. And even if they outlast you, you're not going to be able to do anything with them at a certain point. And thus the admonition of the New Testament to the rich is, be rich in faith.
Legs straight up.
And the admonition of the poor is, be rich in faith.
Now remember, if you need a lecture, let's support.
And I close it this way. Why should the poor man rejoice? Because his exaltation is in Christ. Why should the rich man rejoice? It's because of humility.
That's Christ. Drop the hands down.
You see, Christ bears both the poverty of his poor elect and the humility of his rich elect. And both the rich and the poor must look to Christ and realize that he who was rich for our sake became poor, that we through his poverty might become rich, and that though he existed in essence as God, he made himself no reputation, but condescended in humility to abandon his word, in order that he might be a servant assuming a human nature, so that what he would receive at the end would be far greater than the miserable temporal riches of this life. Verse 12 closes it out. Look at verse 12. Here it is.
Upper body stays exactly the same.
Blessed is the man that does what?
You're gonna rock the feet.
That's what James was saying in verse 2, wasn't it?
Ready, go.
For when he is what? That's verses 3 all the way through verse 11, isn't it? When he is tried, watch this now. He shall receive. Do you see it? He shall receive. Did God say to the devil-minded man, let him not think that he shall what? Receive. The man that endures shall receive. The man that bears under, the woman that bears under, the people that bear under shall receive. When shall they receive? When the test is over. When shall they receive? When the Lord comes again. What shall they receive? The reward of glory. They shall receive the reward of glory, but not those who are wavering, not those who are double-minded, not those who are vacillating. They will not receive. Scary truth.
Five.
Scary truth.
Six.
Scary truth.
Seven.
That you would allow your wealth and riches to happen. That you stand before Christ on the last day.
Well,
saved because you trusted in your riches.
green.
Depart from me.
Brown.
I never knew you. As Mary put it in her song in Luke chapter 1, he had sent the rich away. But he filled the hungry soul.
Elbows on either shoulder, the first one. This hurts your lower back.
If you will, turn back in your Bibles to the book of James, chapter 2. James, chapter 1. I'm sorry, James, chapter 1. And you can follow me in your pastor's commentary as well. As we continue our observation of James, exhortation to the church and to us as well to grow up into Christ in all things. You know, when we are dealing with the subject of maturity in Christ, that requires at least two steps. The first step is that you must be in Christ. So if you're not in Christ, maturity is not a possibility for you until you come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, until He is in you and you are in Him. Because the growth factor of being a Christian is the net consequence of union to Jesus.